evening and welcome to Your Money, Your Call. I'm Chris Gray. On tonight's property edition of Your Money, Your Call, we'll be talking about what to buy in 2010 and how to finance it. Joining me on the panel of experts tonight is Louis Christopher, who's the Managing Director of SQM Research, who's an expert in analysing and identifying property trends around Australia. Also with us tonight is John Mansomelli from Mortgage Choice, who can help you through the maze of financing options. So we're here to... Now, Louis, the big question for the night is where do we buy in 2010? Now, just to start it off, there's two rules, I guess, is quite often this is a show, most of us are pro-capital growth, kind of close to the main cities. Margaret Shine on Monday is quite often more rural properties. Let's start off maybe with the more ones out of town. What are the main reasons that people invest in those kind of areas? So what are the pros for that kind of investing?
People generally, when they look at, say, the rural areas, the mining towns as an example, generally you can get a very high yield. We're talking about getting yields, say, above 6%. Sometimes up to 8 to 10% are not uncommon. So it's often a yield play. On top of that...
Why is that? Why do outer areas get bigger yields?
Great question, Chris. And that's because there's greater risk. And that is the bottom line. The thing is with these rural towns is that you tend to see a lot more volatility. You can have a situation, as an example, and we saw this once again in some of the WA mining towns, where if you have a big fall in global commodity prices brought on by, say, a world recession, those mining towns can really get hit hard. You can have very high unemployment, the mine shuts down. I can tell you right now, the rents fall with the housing naturally, and it'll be very, very hard to sell. So there's a lot more volatility at play there with some of these mining towns. Mind you, when the times are good, they can be very, very good.
Okay. Running to you, John, I know you've got more of a kind of city kind of firm. Do you deal with any of those outer areas, or do you get anything from Mortgage Choice that makes borrowing in those areas easier or more difficult?
Look, if each lender has their own risk appetite. So depending on the lender, they will ask for a certain amount of deposit. Now, each lender knows these areas are typically a lot more volatile and will often ask for a bigger deposit.
So you really need to know your postcode before you start getting pre-approved for finance.
Yeah, that's right. Banks have done all the research and can see there's a lot of volatility, and they may sometimes put higher LVR restrictions on, say, a capital city orientated investment.
Yeah.
So it's certainly doable.
And I think one of the advisors that we had last week was also saying, like, certain sizes of land, then once it goes over a certain size, then it potentially becomes more risky. Is that potentially right as well?
Yeah, a lot of lenders will start to see land as working land, like if big acreage, is it a farm? They'll ask the question, you're trying to derive an income from the farm, and there's a completely different risk.
So that's more of a business lending rather than residential investment.
Right. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So Louis, then let's get on to, I guess, more the capital city type of investing. What are the main advantages and disadvantages of that?
Okay, well, generally speaking, the capital city housing market generally goes on a lower yield than what we see for rural. So 3-4% is not uncommon. That's very average that you see across the capital cities in terms of what properties go for. So generally a lower rental yield. There's a reason for that as well, and that is because the capital cities generally do experience higher capital growth over the medium to long term. Doesn't happen every year. And of course the capital cities are also susceptible to national global recessions, especially if you see rapid unemployment. But that's the trade-off that you see between rural and capital cities.
Okay, and sometimes people talk about the CBD markets. Now, are they separate in a way to the capital cities in that the main difference with the CBD sometimes people talk about is that there's no shortage of supply because obviously people can keep building up into the sky? Or do you generally still treat that as a similar kind of market?
Good question.
It is a good question. And
That's why I'm here.
Look, it all depends what you're buying in the capital cities and how close we are talking about the capital city.
So if we're talking right in the centre where you've got these thousands...
We're talking in the CBD and we're just talking about multi-storey units. Yes, there is an ongoing risk that the market could be regularly flooded with new supply. And yes, that has happened in the past. That said, I've also seen investors do quite well out of capital city units and apartments, once again, it's all about how well have they bought. That's really important. You can still do well buying off the plan, but you really got to do your research there, because naturally the developers are there to try and maximise their margin. So they'll put these properties on as high possible prices as the market's willing to bear.
And developers are pretty clever, aren't they? So where you buy your normal property from your average mum or dad,
yep,
their marketing plans are completely different to developers that are running $100 million businesses.
Oh, no doubt about it. But, you know, we're not here, of course, then.
Yeah. So, Louis, we're going to start trying to close you down. Where do we invest in Australia?
Look, I am most bullish on the Sydney housing market.
And why is that?
A number of factors. We have been seeing, firstly, a situation where unemployment has not gone as high as what we actually all predicted it would with the downturn. So it looks like we're already seeing unemployment top out in the Sydney market, which is good. That just shows that we shouldn't have an issue over big defaults at this point in time. I think we're completely safe with that now.
And when you say Sydney, you're talking about the capital city or kind of New South Wales?
I'm talking about Greater Sydney.
Right.
Okay, so capitals, you know, in the CBD, you know, generally speaking, the whole city. There are pockets, which I'll talk about later, where I'm sort of more bullish and less bullish on.
Okay.
But yes, overall, Sydney has an issue with regard to an undersupply of property coming into the marketplace, particularly at the affordable end of the market. We mentioned before building approvals in New South Wales being, you know, at like lows below what we had in 1983. Okay, and that's predominantly because of what's been happening in Sydney.
Is that unsustainable, Lloyd, that level of construction activity? That is just, is it true that we're getting to a lot of immigration?
Well, yes, we are seeing. I mean, the population growth rate for Sydney is now running at about 1.2% per annum. And the number of dwellings to meet that is that population's just simply not been happening. We've been building on average in Sydney, it's about 20,000 dwellings, every couple of years, and that's not really enough that we need for that type of population growth rate. That said, though, when I look at, say, the upper end of the market, we did see quite a correction occur in 2008 for the upper end of the marketplace, and that's always been the situation in Sydney, where if you have a recession, that the upper end of the market really does correct hard. We've had that. In our opinion, we believe next year, where we're most bullish on is, once again, the upper end of the marketplace. We believe there'll be a good recovery, assuming we have a normal economy next year.
Okay.
Right, okay. And I guess for people that, say, aren't into Sydney, they want to invest on the doorstep, where next from Sydney if you're not into the Sydney market?
Look, I would stick overall to the capital cities. I'm cautious of the holiday areas. That part of the market's taken a beating as well. So you could take a contrarian approach and say, well, now's the time to buy into coastal holiday retreat property. But I'd be very cautious. I haven't seen a bottom there yet. I think it could still fall further potentially. So I would stick predominantly with the capital cities, especially if you're starting out your portfolio and you're making your first or second investment. Now, you want to make sure that those first two are right. You know, obviously, we don't want dud properties at any point in time, but given that the first property's, you know, it's your biggest investment to begin with, you've got to make sure that's right, and you should go for the safe option.
So the capital city's going to give you more the guarantee. Obviously, if you live further out of town and you want to do something on your doorstep, then fair enough, do it on your doorstep. But I guess investing somewhere else and doing it rurally is just risk on top of risk, because you don't know the market and it's potentially a risk.
Also, financing. And again, going back to, there may be an issue in coming up with a bigger deposit as well. So that thrown in with the fact that capital cities have shown a traditional return.
Yeah.
Why not?
And look, I'm a fan of capital cities. I'm trying to put some balance in this.